In this video, I take you behind the scenes of the Rustic Songbird Podcast, where I interview Kyla Simone, who is a singer-songwriter, recording artist, and founder of Girls and Guitars Official. Kyla has a vision for bringing together like-minded musicians and mentoring the next generation of female guitarists. This is an awesome conversation, and I hope that you're encouraged and inspired. Make sure to hit that subscribe button for even more interviews with people in the music industry to equip you to take your music to the next level. Make sure to hit that subscribe button, and let's get started. My guest on the show today is Kyla Simone. She is a recording artist, a songwriter. She is a musician and specifically a guitarist, which I'm super excited to talk about. She has created an amazing community online and series of events called Girls and Guitars. We're going to talk all about it today. But first, I want to welcome you, Kyla, to the show. Thank you for your time being on the show today and talking about the music industry from your perspective as an artist, but also as someone who's trying to create a platform for other women who are playing guitar. I just love that so much and can't wait to talk all about it. So welcome to the show.
Thank you. I'm so happy to be here. I'm definitely honored that you thought of me. And I'm always excited to talk about my baby, which is Girls and Guitars.
Yay. Well, I love that you created it. And the more and more I read into it, I read your website and followed what you were doing on Instagram. And I thought, she had to be on the show. This is so, so good. I love what you're doing. And so first I wanted to talk to you about like your musical journey and then your vision for Girls and Guitars, how people can get connected with what you're doing. So tell me how you got started in your songwriting and guitar playing.
Yeah, so I've been doing music forever. I come from a, you know, like a lot of artists. Sorry if my earbud keeps falling. I have the tiniest ears ever. And these things barely.
Same problem. Mine always pop out.
So I come from a long line of artists and singers and guitarists. So my dad plays, my uncles play, and my brother plays. So I kind of fell into my personal passion for guitar right about when I got ready to go for college. So I was a little bit of a late bloomer as far as becoming an instrumentalist, but I did always have a passion and a love for music, and I started songwriting in my childhood. And then more seriously, I, you know, got into the artist thing in the early 2000s. So picking up the guitar was just a great experience for me because I was a very shy, I was kind of shy, you know, to sing by myself and that kind of thing. The guitar was sort of my security blanket. It was
Isn't
something
that funny?
I could kind of...
You can like hide behind the guitar.
Exactly.
Same, I was shy too. I totally relate to that.
So it was definitely like one of the best things. My mom gave me that guitar for my birthday. Not for my birthday. She gave it to me for Christmas. That's what it was. She gave it to me for Christmas, and I was getting ready to leave Maryland and go to Philadelphia for school. So all throughout my college years, you know, I started learning and playing. I'm self-taught. My dad has, you know, been instrumental in helping guide me, especially in recent years as an artist and as a musician. And you know, I performed a lot. I got out and did my artist thing, even though I was scared to death. Fear
That's
is never
so nerve-wracking.
Exactly. But fear is never an excuse to not pursue your gift and your talent. You know?
I love that.
And life is just way too short for you not to just go all in. So even terrified, I still launched out and jumped out as an artist. And so I've been just doing my artist thing. I've put out some singles. I had put out an EP many years back. And, you know, I'm working on a little bit of music now, finally, after some time. But, so Girls and Guitars came to be in 2016. And really what it came from was, you know, the phrase of, like, if you don't see something to create it. And so that's kind of the mindset I took because I wanted to be able to connect with other women and especially women, you know, women of color, especially because I don't see a whole lot of us.
Right. So you created what you saw was needed. And I love that.
So it was crazy because when we got ready to plan our first showcase, I had started to Instagram. Thank you, Instagram, because... I was able to find, you know, a few artists here and there. And I was like, whoa, like there's more artists than I think. And then mm-hmm. people started tagging me to other artists when they sort of saw what I was doing. And now we're like, we've provided a platform for almost like about 50 artists so far in the years that we've been doing it. We've done showcases here in the DMV. We've done a showcase in Nashville. We've done a showcase in Atlanta. Mm-hmm. So we've done more than like what I anticipated or expected. This thing sort of took off on its own.
Yeah, it grew because of the need. I love that, that you saw there was like a hole that needed to be filled. It was like, you know, people need to hear from different types of musicians, especially girls and guitars, and promoting women of color who are playing guitar and like giving them an opportunity to like have a new audience. You know, I love that you're doing showcases, and you were doing that in person before, you know, quarantine hit. But then you just recently in the last couple of months were doing a series called Six Strings of Hope, right? So you were actually doing Instagram Lives and making that showcase a virtual event. So tell me how that came together with Six Strings of Hope.
Yeah, so, you know, for the last year or so, after last year, you know, being a business person, it's hard. You know, it's hard sometimes doing this stuff. And a lot of the money is coming out of my pockets. And so last year, I went through some transitions. I actually got laid off my job around February last year. And so I shifted jobs. I got a new job, but it just kind of changed the dynamic for me. And I had to cut back. So I did a showcase last year around fall. Then I was like, you know what? I'm not going to do any more showcases for at least a year. And I'm just going to focus on building the business side of things, because I have all these, you know, visions for, you know, what's next for us beyond showcases. And so I had no intention of doing any more showcases for at least a year. And then all of this stuff happened, and it's like it opened up the avenues of creativity and sort of like accessibility to different, you know, crowds of people and that kind of thing through the virtual world. And I was like, well, there's really nothing stopping us, you know, from
being like, why not? Let's do it.
Right. So, and then, you know, now there's more eyes, there's more, you know, we've had more people attend our virtual shows. You know, we've had a good turnout for our physical shows, but we've done small venues that are like 60 to 100 people. So now, you know, you've got the worldwide, you know, internet who can access what you're doing. They don't have to physically be there. And so Six Strings of Hope was just providing some hope and some joy to people, because life is really heavy right now. And music always heals and it helps. And so that was really what it was about, bringing on some dynamic artists, some wonderful women who have a story and they have a heart to share and empower people through their music, through their own unique gift. And what I love is every artist is a little bit different. They just have their own vibe. And I think it's really cool and the world should hear it. So I've had some really wonderful artists who've been gracious enough to grace our virtual stage. And it's been a lot of fun. So we're, what, I think our fourth show, I believe, is coming up for so far that we've done. So that's been a lot of fun.
That is so good. And I love that you were willing to organize it and put it together, and that it's a community of people supporting each other. So it's not like one person doing showcases, not one person doing concerts. It's like everyone's helping each other to promote it and to get the word out. And I know for me, I was introduced to new artists because of the artists that you were promoting. And so people are going to find you under Girls and Guitars and think, oh, okay, they're promoting this person, I'll check out their music. So I love that you have so many females that you're promoting here, because I'm all about like girls who play guitar, because I am one, and because I just love promoting other people that are writing original music, especially people that are promoting good things and like faith. And I want to be part of that, you know, pushing out during this time. Like you said, there's so much pain happening in our country and in our world. And right now, as Christians, we need to be a message of hope. And so that's exactly what you're doing. And like you said, music is so powerful. So could you tell me a little bit about the response you've gotten after people have attended, or the comments you're getting from people that are watching the Six Strings of Hope events?
Yeah, so we always have, so my team, they're usually on there. I have a team of volunteers. They've been with me from the very beginning, and they're really all just really great friends of mine. We've been friends for many years, and they saw what I was trying to do, and they've jumped on board to help. So they'll be kind of watching the comments and everything, because I'm interviewing. I'm watching, but I'm also paying, you know, attention to the artists and that kind of thing. But they always text me afterwards, and they're like, you know, telling me the positive remarks, that people are having a good time, that they, you know, point out different artists that they really loved. And, you know, people have shared that this is what they needed, you know, a specific song touched them or reached, you know, into something they were going through at the time. So we've gotten a lot of really great feedback from people who attend our virtual showcase and our physical showcases.
Yeah, that is so good. So that's just confirmation that this is so needed. What you're doing is important. And I want to affirm that as well. Like, what you're doing is such an encouragement. Mm-hmm. And I think as people find out about it, they're going to, you know, just continue to grow, and the community is going to spread. And I love, you know, how it's set up to encourage other artists, but also you're empowering women to be mentors to others who are just coming on. Maybe somebody's going to see that and say, hey, there's a girl that plays guitar. Maybe I could do that too. You know, maybe I can learn guitar. There's a lot of people that are singers or even writers. They write lyrics and don't play an instrument to put the music to it. And I know a lot of people listening to this podcast, maybe lyricists, or they write poems, poetry, but don't play an instrument. So what encouragement would you give to someone who's listening, wants to pick up guitar and play, but hasn't started learning yet?
Yeah, so I would say just jump in and do it. A lot of times we can talk ourselves out of doing things, or we can look and say, you know, oh, I feel like I'm a little too old or this or that. But most of the women who are a part of Girls and Guitars, like, picked up the guitar, I'd say within the last 5 or 10 years. And we're all adults, you know. So you're never too grown to pick up a craft. You just have to have discipline, and you have to have a dedication to yourself and wanting to see yourself thrive, you know, in that area. And once it clicks for you, you know, that you're willing to take the time and put the time in to do it, then you'll do whatever's necessary to make sure that you become successful at that particular thing. The one thing that I want through Girls and Guitars, and one of our next level you know, goals is creating Girls and Guitars University, which I'm in talks now with my guitar teacher, and in working on a strategy for putting together some curriculums for you know, learning guitar. We also want to incorporate bass and ukulele just to start out. And then also not just that, but songwriting and music business, all of the things that make an artist well-rounded. You know, so that you can be successful. But the biggest thing for guitar is that a lot of times we learn the guitar just enough to get by. But we don't really think about, if we master this instrument, how many great opportunities will, you know, be at our fingertips because we've mastered this instrument, not just our voice, you know, but our instrument as well. And so that is kind of what I'm working on as on a personal level. And what I'm encouraging other people to do is go beyond just, you know, I'm just going to jump in and just start, but I'm going to take this thing, I'm going to see this thing all the way through and master it.
And guitar tool, I mean, it's a way to accompany yourself as a singer. And if you are the one writing the songs, the more you get comfortable playing guitar, like learning new chords, you can kind of take it in a different direction melodically, or you can build the song in dynamics better as you get more comfortable with different strumming patterns. And so I see what you're saying. If you're mastering it, then again, like, you have more expansion on what you can do musically. And so a lot of people will start just learning a few chords, and that's great. That's a great start, but there's so much more, like you said. And I know for me, I use a capo a lot because I'm singing and I'm like leading worship and playing and stuff. So I'll use a capo and use a lot of the same chords. But if I'm songwriting, I like to change it up. And if I have some room to like try different keys or try different chords, that can take the song in a different direction. And so I do think there's a place for simplicity and learning your first few chords. But like you said, if you're ready to take it to the next level, there's way more that you can do and learn. And it's just going to expand you as an artist and your songs you're writing. So tell me a little bit more about your long-term vision for girls and guitars and what you hope for it to be.
Yeah, so I wanted to really be a strong network, you know, of women who can come together and we can, you know, this is of course post, you know, after all the COVID stuff.
Once everything's reopened.
But where we can, as a community, we can come together, and it can be in different states too. It doesn't have to just be in one place, but come together and just sort of support one another. We host something monthly called Circle of Fifths, which is a girls and guitars support group for singer-songwriters, guitarists. Awesome. And so we've been meeting since April, and it has just been, it's been a nice time, like the support and the camaraderie. And we started a WhatsApp group. We're gonna grow it gradually. But I wanna see stuff like that where we come together and do more things beyond just the showcases, because of course we're gonna always do our concerts. I want to create a platform where there can be actual community. You know, we can go to a park, meet up, you know, do a meetup and go to a park and, you know, sing and those kind of things. So that's sort of a grassroots thing. Then of course with Girls in Guitars University, I want to fully build that out to be a great resource for women to, it'll be a membership based resource for women to take their guitar playing to the next level. And how I see it happening is that, you know, as they're growing in their artistry, we then open up a junior sector, which would be our younger girls. And then now creating a platform, and a lot of the women who have been a part of our network can now be in a position to mentor and help the next generation grow into quality, you know, musicians and artists and pave the way. So right now I'm starting with our 20, 30s and up age group. And then, you know, we grow into a platform that now also services our younger girls and, you know, and develops them as well. I'm also thinking about other things like, you know, having a app, you know, songwriting apps and, you know, the ultimate goal that we have, which this situation put a little wrench in, but right. I still think it's going to happen, God willing, is yes. that I want to have a physical
facility. Lord's in it. He works it out.
So my intention was to have open a facility where we have, you know, our venue, of course, but also space for learning experiences, you know, co-working, you know, it would just be a space completely built out to cater to our, you know, demographic of female singer-songwriters and guitarists. So I have the whole plan drafted up and everything I write down, because I feel like if I can visualize it, it's gonna happen.
Yes, and as you're speaking your vision too, I just believe that it's part of speaking it into existence and that it's going to happen. And I love documenting part of this, but I'm a visionary too, so I understand like how exciting it is, and I can tell like, you're business minded, you've got a plan, like you know what you want it to look like, and I really believe the Lord's given you that to help so many people. I was getting chills while listening to you say it. I was like, yes, this is so good and so needed. So I love your vision for it, and just like the grassroots of you going for it and building slowly and just taking it like one big time.
Yeah,
like doing the showcases and then you know, working up to having a venue and having the mentorship of the old women teaching the younger women and like getting young girls started in guitar. I think it's such a good outlet. Like playing guitar has been such a good expression for me, like especially going through teenage years. Like I was playing guitar and writing songs about all the feelings and all the things I was learning. And even now, like songwriting is such a good expression for me. It's therapeutic. And then the songs we're writing are going to reach so many people.
Yeah.
Like you said, because music is so powerful. And so I just see it as a ripple effect of what you're doing now, vision for now, as it grows, it's going to expand to more people and keep growing. And it's going to connect people with music in a way that you won't even see all of the things that are going to happen. It's just so exciting. I love that. So tell me what you're doing with your music specifically. You said that you have released several songs, several singles and an EP. So what does that look like for you moving forward? Are you working on new music?
Yeah, so I'm working on a new single. Me and my guitar instructor have been, her name is Jen. She has a company called J Bliss Studios. And so she's doing virtual lessons right now, if anyone's interested. We're actually going to be collaborating to host a few guitar clinics virtually as well. But awesome. Yeah, so she helped me kind of like step outside of my box, because a lot of my songs from back in the day, you know, was my kind of basic chords type of thing. Mm-hmm. So this song will represent me stretching myself a little bit more. And so this morning, actually, I relaid my guitar parts and, learning how to, now have my studio set up at home, and it sounds really nice. Woo-hoo! I'm real picky about that stuff.
Oh, I know. And,
so now that
there's so much that goes into it.
Exactly. So now that I have my own setup, you know, I have more of a drive to like get stuff done. So I'm starting with this first single. I put myself on a break, you know, last year, because I was focusing on girls and guitars. Mm-hmm. As an artist, I put myself on a break, and also I knew I wanted to get some training, because I wanted to step my I want to level up as a guitarist myself, and mm-hmm. be able to stand out more as an artist. And I know that will come, you know, when I perfect certain elements. And so that's what I've been working on. So now I feel like, okay, I'm baby stepping my toe back into the water a little bit.
It's time. It's happening.
So I wrote a song that I really, really like. And so I'm excited about working on that, recording it myself, and bringing in some other musicians to lay their parts and stuff, getting it mixed mm-hmm. and mastered and such. I don't know yet the exact of when it's going to be released, but I am working on a
awesome. And I love hearing about women that are learning to produce your own music and making it happen. That just makes me so happy. It makes my heart smile. And I'm like, yes, more women producers, more women guitarists. Like, the world needs our voices and our music so much. And so there's just so much room for every style, for every perspective. And so I just love what you're doing all around. It just makes me so happy. I want to share how people can connect with you and Girls and Guitars. So I want people to know how they can find your music and get involved with what you're doing with Girls and Guitars. So please share all the best places to find you online.
Yeah, absolutely. So to connect with me directly, you can go to kylasimone.com, and you'll find links to all my social media. And my music is on iTunes and Spotify. So if you look up Kyla Simone, you should be able to see my, you know, all my different works. I always tell people, if you're going to listen to it on Spotify, like add me to your playlist or like something so that you're listening over and over, because that's a good way to support if you want to support an artist through the streaming platforms. I'm on all of your favorite streaming and digital platforms. And as far as with Girls and Guitars, you can connect with us on, of course, through our website, which is girlsandguitarsofficial.com. That's girlsandguitarsofficial.com. And then also we're on Instagram, probably most. So at Girls and Guitars Official. Same thing on Facebook, at Girls and Guitars Official. So everything is at Girls and Guitars Official.
Awesome. So glad to have you on the show today and hear about your music as well as you're doing to promote other musicians. And I just want to say, keep at it, girl. This is amazing. Like, what you're doing is so, so good. And I knew I had to have you on the show to talk about it. I want everybody to go find you, see what you're doing, get involved, figure out ways to, you know, support the community. Let's grow the community together and go share some love. So thank you so much for being here and for sharing part of your story about your music. God bless you. Thank you so much for what you're doing.
God bless you. And thank you, Lydia. I really had a great time. I love your spirit, and I love what you're doing as well. And so thank you for empowering and uplifting, us artists as we, you know, launch out in faith.
Yes. Yes, taking one step at a time, like you said, baby steps earlier. That's what it takes, and you're doing an amazing job.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Thank you so much for watching this behind the scenes episode of the Rustic Songbird Podcast. I want to invite you to subscribe to this channel and give it a like if you enjoyed this conversation. Make sure to subscribe so you don't miss more videos like this coming soon. And subscribe to the Rustic Songbird Podcast for all the previous episodes, interviews with people in the music industry to encourage you, to inspire you, to equip you to take your music to the next level. All right, hit that subscribe button and I will catch you in the next episode.